Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Brian. We're going to continue on with this week's theme of saxophone, but not jazz. We're looking at the awesome Ishan. Checked out some of his works earlier in the channel's lifetime, but we're going to check out Undercurrent today, which I think is the longest song I've heard from him. Looking at a 10-minute song with this one. All right, so let's dive into it and see what Ishan's bringing to the table today. Yeah, I like the clean guitar, or maybe even acoustic guitar, sitting behind the electric. Bass coming in real hard. Bring the song in heavy just to immediately back it off. Really beautiful melody line on these vocals. Really loving that bass sitting in the background. That's not a bass sit in the backgrounds. Yeah, that syncopated snare hit. Trudging along real hard, it's heavy. Man, so what is that, like an 11-8? 4-4-4-4-4-4-4-4-11-8. Four, we've got two saxophones. The right one is an alto. Maybe the left one is too. I don't know. There we go. Yeah, they both sound like altos. Really cool though. Was not expecting any songs this week with two saxophones. Yeah. Okay, this is the driving section. Performance right here, really allowing a chaotic sound, style, effects put on here to keep the momentum moving on these long held out notes. Drums just killing it. Strings or a synth or something on the outsides of that last section. It's very faint. Yeah, I'm really digging this riff. A variation of that last riff to lead us into this next idea. So good. And once again, we have that bass snare. Right? That right there just kind of gives it a little bit of juxtaposition other than just the alternating bass snare. Really gives it that groove in the middle of the phrase. Yeah, hit me with them, those harmonies. I like that call and response. On the outside, so the guitars on the outside are doing a response to the bass hits in the center. Gorgeous vibrato on that sax playing. Yeah, that was fascinating. Definitely a nice area of heavy music, but keeping it a bit more palatable, and just kind of bringing in that sax too. The entire song kind of feels like modern hard rock to me for most of it. Which again, like I said, kind of it's more palatable. It's definitely a heavier style, but it's not really metal. There's definitely the harsh vocals there that kind of push it a little bit into maybe less palatable areas. But for the most part, yeah, I think this is very listenable. And like I said, it's just a really nice middle point between harsher styles of music and more palatable ones. So what I think I really love about this song first, but I want to dive into before we get into anything else, and there's a lot of stuff I think we're going to talk about here. It's easily going to be a lengthy video, is the progression of the entire song. We start out with a fairly heavy idea. It's not our heaviest, but at the point, we might be. We don't know what the future holds. We start out with a fairly heavy idea and immediately rein it in to something a bit more chill and laid back. Interestingly, not only does this foreshadow when we get back to larger moments, but it also foreshadows an idea that we don't revisit until the very end of the track, if I remember correctly. And we bring the same idea back with a little bit of variation to it. We put it into a new context. But it's really interesting to hear it here. That just we're gonna hear it again much later. Just wait for it. And if you make that connection, it's like, whoa, they brought it back. That was such a small part of the opening. So yeah, we start up here, we bring it down, right? And then the rest of the song is a constant build upwards. We don't ever have any moments where we go from something heavy and we bring it down a little bit and bring it back up. It is just a constant growth. We start out in this small section, we get these really nice vocal harmonies, we build up into more electric guitars, and then we bring in heavier drums, wider guitars, beefier bass lines. We bring in the sax, we bring in the harsh vocals, like everything just gets added on to where it's bigger and bigger and bigger until the final moment when we bring the intro back in. And I really like this because, at least in retrospect, I don't think I really noticed it along the ride. It wasn't until the end when I realized, oh, we never really dropped back down. We just had a constant rising, energy throughout the entire track. But while I was listening to it, I never really noticed it. I was just kind of along for the ride, right? But I really like this constant build. It feels like the song is always progressing in a singular direction, and it's just kind of carrying us all along with it. It does kind of cycle ideas here and there, but I don't know if I can call it like verse chorus because the music is rather linear. We are just constantly moving in a forward direction, upward in energy and largeness and heaviness. I think we can even add to that. So while there are a couple of moments where we revisit some lyrical things that I think I noticed, and there's even some ideas musically that get recontextualized. I had mentioned one part where we took the underlying guitar riff, altered it just a little bit. We removed some of the fuzz or something. It just became clearer to hear though. I don't know what was going on there. Could have just switched over to a different guitar tone, right? A bunch of different effect pedals, and just kind of reduce some of the fuzziness, make it a little cleaner. And we take this idea and we run it into the next concept, which has this cleaner element to it that's not so fuzzy. but brings in the heavier drums and harsh vocals and stuff like that, but we still find a way to retain this one riff within both of them. So, yeah, there are moments of recurring ideas, but it's more of, I think that's more, it's a recurring idea, not a looping song structure. So, I don't know if we have verse-chorus ideas in here. To me, like I said, it just feels linear, but there are elements that I can hear being reutilized, which helps it all kind of feel unified. Even when we get to some of the heavier sections at the end, I can say, oh, it's got this callback from here, or it's got a callback from over here, and it just brings the whole song together. It feels like a unified idea, rather than just a series of isolated events that happen to be put next to each other in a song. And just like this entire adventure from the small to the big is great. I'm still a little interested in the opening. Other than the callback for it at the end, it feels out of place. We start at like 7 maybe. We don't know it's a 7 yet. Maybe it's a 5. In fact, now I'm trying to compare it to like the biggest moment there. But yeah, we start at this higher point, and then we bring it down to a 2 instantly. We're only in that loud section for a few moments. And in that sense, I mean, it kind of feels like in media res, where we would start in a story at the action point, and then say, oh, you might be wondering how I got here. And then like 2 weeks later, it goes across the screen, and we're like at a happier point. Like, that's kind of what it feels like. It is in media res in music. But I didn't really get much of a story here. This was just a journey, so to speak. And so because of that, I don't really have any context for that opening section. It sort of just exists. And while I like it, you know, we start and we immediately dip down. I think that's a great way to start the song. Get my attention. I'm like, yeah, let's get into it. And they're like, also, wait, no. You're going to see how we get up to this point. Very in media res. But, you know, it's cool, but it doesn't really mean much to me yet. And, you know, cool, there's always room for that, right? Rule of cool is very awesome. I'm always down for any art, whether it's music or film or whatever, based on rule of cool. As long as it's done well. Because it can get, like, overdone. It's kind of like camp, where you kind of don't have to know that you're doing it in order for it to be executed well. Rule of cool can come off very cringy as well. But yeah, I mean, it's a cool way to start the song, but I don't really see a purpose other than that. And there doesn't always have to be one, but I, you know, that's my job here, is to look for the purpose, why things are added or done the way that they were done. And I'm just not seeing one there, but I enjoyed it. And, you know, maybe that's all that needs to be there. After that, we bring it down. And the cool thing, you know, I was just talking about how sections have callbacks to other sections. Or foreshadowing, you know, in this case. I think this is the only time I heard it. In the opening, I had mentioned that the electric guitars have some clean guitars, or maybe some acoustic guitars, on the outsides of the sound. They're not very in your face. I think you kind of have to listen for them. But they're there. They're not really hidden. They're just not what's prominently put in the spotlight. And I think it's really cool that I picked up on that. And then like 10 seconds later, we went into a section that exclusively used that sound, that timbre. So, you know, we bring it down. We get these acoustic guitars. I think this is where that super funky bass came in. Maybe that was the next section. We got the vocals coming in, very smooth, great harmonies, real chill drums, just kind of existing, right? Just very chill. I think it's a really great counter to what we just were in and where we were going to. It's a great way to start the song out, just kind of laid back, right? We'll explore some ideas based on some of these rhythms, based on some of these melodies. We're going to kick it up a notch, but for a moment, let's just explore what's happening musically. And that's what I get here, because a lot of these rhythms and melodies do show up again with distortion later. To me, this is really about exploring the music for the music's sake before we get into some sonic elements, right? And that's sort of, you know, a lot of what metal is to me, especially the metal that I've come to enjoy. It's the sonic quality of metal. It's heavy, it's harsh, it's got that bite to it. But I also really enjoy metal music that has that stronger melodic and harmonic element to it, that I really appreciate in genres like jazz and classical, and marries the two, right? We get that really strong composition with that really edgy modern metal sound. And I think right here, this is really cool because, you know, Ishan's saying here, you know, listen to the music without all the metalness to it, right? Listen to how gorgeous it is. We're going to put metal on it later and it's going to sound awesome, but there is beauty beneath it. Check it out. And that's kind of what I'm getting here. But it's also just pairs really well with the vocals. I'm curious if the vocals, the story and the lyrics are going to ramp up in intensity over this song. And just kind of going in like an upward momentum, just flying off the rails, no safety, you know, just constant acceleration. And maybe the lyrics are just going to go from like something more calming to something more extreme in a linear fashion to match with what the music is doing. I'm hoping anyways, it doesn't have to be that way. I really like my themes to cohese. That's not a word. To have cohesion in my themes. So, yeah, I'll be looking for that in the lyrics because that's what the music says to me. And this is our lowest point. This is our calmest point. I'm expecting some calm vocals or some calm lyrics here. After this, we move into the next section. We kick it up a little bit. I think we were just about or just under our intro section here. And we also introduced a center bassy instrument. I was fairly certain it was a bass when it came in, and then we did something. We came back to the tone though, and I was like, is that a bass? I don't know. And it had something to do with the way that the notes were created. The lead in and the lead out of these tones did not sound like the plucking of a string. And I mean, it could have been finger picked, right? And those have a little bit more softness, more roundness to it. And there's a nice warm roundness to this bass tone. It really is the attack. The attack is too smooth, I think, for picking of any sort, whether it's finger picking or regular picking or slap. Well, definitely slapping and popping. That's just harsh attacks right there. Unless this person was using a volume pedal and strummed the string and then volumed into it so you could kind of fade in and fade out on them, this sounded more like it was an aerophone, an instrument that you use your air to create sound on. And I just don't know anymore. if someone has insight into that, let me know. That specific instrument, center pan, lower end of the range, in that third section, right after the quiet section, the calm section. It's like I said, I can't really think. Maybe a bassoon, but I also think it would have to have some effects put on it. You know, when they mic it and they record it, and maybe it goes through the microphone into some pedals, or maybe they do it digitally in the audio workstation. I don't know, but it doesn't sound like the pure timbre of a bassoon either. I honestly have no idea what it is. And it really wasn't until the second time it came around, and I had two moments where the phrase had this very interesting airiness to it, that you're just not gonna get on a guitar, on a stringed instrument, outside of maybe bowing. I think you could probably achieve something similar if you used a bow, but I can't imagine the bassist switching to a bow. Would you even can't? I mean, you can bow an electric bass, but what does that sound like? I don't think I've ever heard that before. Anyways, to go from picking to bowing for three notes and then back to picking for a while and then bowing like two or three more notes and then back to picking just sounds very impractical, to say the least. So I'm not saying it can't be done. I'm not saying it's not a base, and I'm not saying it's not a base. It's definitely something. I just don't know what it is. It feels like a bass sometimes, and in a couple of rare occasions, it feels like a distorted bassoon, and I'm just very confused about that tone. But it was neat. And I like being confused about music, right? There's a lot of music I don't know about, and I think that's okay to say. I don't know what's going on here. Someone explain it to me. I mean, those are words that I think everybody just needs to put in their definition. I mean, put into their vocabulary. Can someone explain this to me? I don't get it. I don't know what's going on. I especially feel like we don't hear enough of that in stuff like this, right? Expert reacts or surgeon reacts or whatever, and you just kind of expect them to have all the answers. And I mean, we're all just people, we're a single person, our knowledge is finite. Anyways, I'm getting on a tangent. Let's get back to Ishan. After this, we get into might have been the same area, this first groovy section. Just really dig into it, and drumming. This main idea is alternating bass and snare. We got that boom, ka, boom, ka. Very simple. But what gives it that extra groove, and I pointed it out, was that the snare always has a bass kick in front of it. So we get the boom, boom, ka, boom, boom, ka. And it gives that little bit of extra energy getting into it. It doesn't wait for the beat to come around. It jumps in just a half a beat before, really jumping the gun on it a little bit, and allows you to sort of prime yourself for that headbang, right? You get the unka, unka. It allows you to feel it and follow through. And I think it's really a simple way of driving groove, because it is syncopation. It's not extreme syncopation, but syncopation is just putting notes against the core groove. And putting one in here that is right before what you expect, because everything else is right on a beat, right? Like I said, bass snare, bass snare. You get that bass snare in there, and it changes up things just enough to drive the groove. And it's such a simple little thing. And the drums really aren't doing anything else. The cymbals are kind of going on every downbeat as well here, and that's it. Right? Nobody else is really doing anything syncopated. The guitars have a bit of a riff going on that's a little bit funky rhythmically, but it's also just kind of going along with the time. It really is that one bass kick, a single note that drives all the groove here and makes it feel less rigid than it could be. And I think that's something a lot of people forget is the power of simplicity. We can always say, oh, we should have done this and this and add this layer and that layer. And we listen to a lot of songs that are very intricate and complex. And we kind of hold these up as fantastic songs. And they are, right? There's definitely an allure to complex stuff, but there's also a lot of power in simplicity, just one simple note changing this entire feel. It's always good to remember little things, and I'm glad that Ishan does that. There's definitely some parts in here where we're adding a lot of layers and we have a lot of ideas going on. We can especially hear this in the final moment where it's the most complex aspect of the song, but Ishan also understands the power of simplicity. We have one of the most basic drum beats here. And it works so well in context. I find that fascinating. I love to hear, big names writing rather simple ideas and just it works, right? It's a good reminder of the power of simplicity. What else? Oh, this was where the idea somewhere around here. A lot of these moments, once we got to the heavy part, kind of blurred together for me. We just kind of got heavier, but the riffs themselves were all just like the heavy part. So I'm not sure exactly where this riff came in, but it was interesting in that it's a very hard rock idea, very 70s, 60s. Where did hard rock come in? Somewhere in that area though. And we've talked about this a few times before. where you sort of ride on an open tone and you do something rhythmically interesting, and then you go into a lick at the end of your riff. So you get like dun da da 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 dun da da dun da da dun, right? You get this nice little gallop going on a single note, and then you put a lick at the end of it to accent the phrase, and then you just repeat it over and over and over and over. Ishan does this in an interesting way, because instead of taking a single note and creating a rhythmic riff around it, it's like three notes and sort of just kind of goes up them and goes up them and goes up them, and then has this extended run at the end of it. But the idea is the same. We have a small idea that we use three times, and then a bigger idea that we use at the end to punctuate the phrase, and we repeat it ad nauseum. And it's this nice, like I mentioned, it's a little bit more complex of an idea that is more simple that we've heard many times before. Ishan's just really good at merging simplicity and complexity when they're needed. It never feels too complex. It never feels too simple. And I think that's one of Ishan's strengths, at least to me, is just the ability to know when to go deeper and when to stay a bit shallower just because it works. And that's one of the moments. I just wanted to point it out when I was listening to it. If you heard me chuckle, I think I did around the time I heard this. That's why. I know I picked up the pattern here in the riff. And this is actually the riff that ends up getting reutilized, where it's like super fuzzy and kind of, I don't want to say muddy, but it kind of covers up some of the ideas. And we kind of cut back most of the band for a second, and we clean this up so we can actually hear the individual notes. And then this leads us into the next moment where we keep that idea, but it's the same riff under the next concept as well. We've just changed the guitar timbre, and we allowed the song to reset. Like I said, I think we cut down to just guitar for like two bars, and then we bring the rest of the band back in, but heavier. And when we get to this heavier stuff, it really has the full band behind it. And in a lot of the earlier sections, the guitars are doing their thing, the bass is doing their thing, the drums are holding down a rhythm, and the vocals are doing their thing, usually with some sort of harmony. So we have a lot of these moments where, you know, everybody is doing their own thing. It's a full song, you know, they're working together well, there's nice harmony and counterpoint, some of this stuff. But they're not unified in the sense that we're a wall of sound. But when we get into this next moment, everybody is doing the same thing. We went from something that's more complex to something that's more simple. Every instrument does the same rhythm, same riff. All the guitars are doing the same thing. The bass might even be doing the same thing, just maybe an octave lower. And it just comes in so heavy, so hard. And that's what I'm talking about. Marrying the simplistic with the complex, knowing when to do each. It's just, yeah, I'm filing this away. I don't think I've come up on this so often. I remember picking up a little bit on it last time we checked out Ishan, but it wasn't something that I talked about this excessively. I'm hearing it in pretty much every aspect of this track. Like I said, it's what I'm going to be filing away in my brain under Ishan is complexity and simplicity, finding the medium between them. And then at this point, I believe, is where the saxophones came in, because we have this unified sound underneath that creates a fantastic foundation, and it allows the saxophones to be prominent in the spotlight, kind of like a solo section in, well, jazz or rock or metal, where, you know, everybody just kind of, the rhythm section joins in into a singular idea, which kind of removes all the spotlight from them. It's not so much that we have, you know, a melody line and a harmony line and a bass line and and the meter all doing their own things. Everybody's just kind of this one foundational concept now, just kind of everyone's doing one thing. You don't really have much of a chance to listen to too many ideas, and they just kind of back out of the way of the spotlight and allow whatever's leading at the time to really be what your ear is going to be drawn to naturally. And in this case, it's the saxophones. And there's something interesting going on here. First of all, I'm going to have to talk about that guitar solo that pops up around here as well, because really interesting thing going on there. There's two saxophones though. One is like center right a little bit. It's very prominent, very close. And it's not too far from the center, but it's not dead center either. The other saxophone is like far left and distant and quiet. So, you know, normally when we have harmonies, vocals, you know, we'll have dead center or we'll have equal weighting. They'll both be, you know, left and right. Or, you know, one to a little of each side, you know, 45 degrees either way. But it's all about symmetry, right? They're equal distance from me spatially. They're equal distance horizontally. Here, though, we have one that's pretty close to me in center and one that's far away from me. And it's just, it's odd. I don't know the purpose to it. This is much like the opening where I think it's interesting, but I don't see the reason for it. And so I just kind of have to accept that at face value that this is what Ishan wanted. But, you know, if they were the same ideas, I'd be like, okay, you know, this is just a sonic quality thing, kind of like an echo, right? You hear it here and then it's like way out there and it's kind of distancy. That's not really a word, but they're not though. They're harmonizing. The one close to me is the higher one. The one furthest from me is the lower one. And they are creating dyads on all of these ideas. In fact, there still is a little bit of a rhythmic delay in some of the sections. I'm not sure if that's achieved with a delay. Maybe it is just one saxophone with like pitch changing and delay on it. But the delay doesn't show through on every single note. Sometimes there's a delay and sometimes there's not. It's just, it's really interesting. Yeah. This is a question I would have to ask Ishan. Why? What was going on here? What was the choice here? Because I'm just really not seeing a pattern into any of it or a reason for it. But it is unique, right? I don't think I've ever heard anything like this. I'm kind of attributing it to Ishan's style. Another thing that I can just file away and pick up later, you know, when I hear something like, oh, you know, this is like what Ishan did, right? So, I mean, he's got some free information put in my brain just from being unique. But yeah, so like sometimes there's a delay where you'll hear the center one and then the left panned one slightly after it. But usually they're lined up and they're just creating typical dyads, right? Third apart, fifth apart, very stable harmonies. And yeah, I don't know that I have anything else to say about it. I enjoy what it was doing. I love the harmonies. It's sort of a smooth section. And I hate that I use that word because smooth with saxophone, I immediately think of smooth jazz. And this is not jazz week. And I would actually say that the sax usage here is not jazzy at all. There's a couple of areas where kind of weights are, we add extra weight to the beginning of our grouped faster notes, our eighth notes or 16th notes, that kind of give it a swinginess, but it's not strong enough or often enough for me to really say, oh, there's a swing vibe here. I think it's more just an aesthetic weighting of notes in a few sections. So yeah, this is definitely the first time in the week that I've actually come up to the saxophone part and just said, yeah, this is completely not jazz. And I really appreciate that. I know it's kind of difficult. And even right here, when I was listening to it, I was like, that's kind of jazzy. And I had to like really correct myself. Brain, why is it jazzy? And my brain's like, yeah, I don't know. It just sounds like a sax, so it's jazz, right? I'm like, exactly. This isn't jazz. Brain, figure out what's going on here. But yeah, for a moment there, I was like, yeah, it's kind of jazzy. But it really isn't, right? And like I said, the past two tracks we've checked out for the week, the first one, I'm still like 50-50 on, you know, I've had conversations about it. I found out the solos weren't, improvised. So that kind of helps give it more of that rock feel. That was the Pink Floyd one. But like the overall track is still very bluesy to me. And yesterday we checked out, something. Oh, Tesseract. Yeah, And when the sax came in, a little bit of a jazziness to it, but not too strong. This one, though, is just nothing, right? And I really appreciate that. That's what this week's all about. And I know it's kind of difficult because, like I just explained, I kind of fall into that trap, too. I hear a saxophone, I'm like, that's pretty jazzy. Doesn't matter what they're playing. And it's like, that's some jazzy saxophone. I think a lot of it just has to do with the way that a lot of people phrase saxophones, because we kind of have a general idea of what they're supposed to sound like. You know what I want for this week? A little bit of an aside. We'll get back to Ishan in a second. What I really want this week is for somebody to write a guitar part and then have a saxophone play it. Right? Or, you know what actually would work too? Have them write a bass part. Or for it to be a symphonic metal track that features saxophone, where it's written like a classical saxophone part. Because saxophone isn't just a jazz instrument, it shows up in classical music a lot. Especially alto, tenor, and bari sax. All three of them are very prominent in classical music. And that would just not feel jazzy at all. Classical music has a completely different vibe, and classical music lines up with metal very well, which is why I'd mentioned symphonic metal for this. But it doesn't necessarily have to be. But yeah, just this whole idea here of just taking it out. Because I think the thing is listening to these three tracks, it's not so much that they're introducing jazz per se. We don't have jazzy chords or jazzy, melodies or anything like that. But what we do have is a sort of a jazzy phrasing and a jazzy performance. There is a very different way that a jazz saxophonist will play the saxophone in a jazz environment than a classical one will play in, a symphony. They have very different styles. Same with trumpet, trombone, any of them, right? It's not really an embouchure difference. It's more of a flow difference. It's the way that you carry notes and air through your body into the instrument. It really is a very different feeling physically of how you play your instrument. And I think that's the thing here, is that, you know, if you go and listen to a sax quintet or quartet or trio or whatever of a piece of music that's written for a classical style, I don't think you're ever going to say, oh, that sounds jazzy just because there's saxophones in it. It really is that in the, I just think most people, when they think of the saxophone, they think of the jazzier stuff. You know, they think of Careless Whisper, right? They think of that sound. And so when they add sax to their music, that's what they add. They add something that might not necessarily utilize jazz composition, but has that phrasing. Of phrases. Excellent use of words, Brian. But, you know, the way that the phrase is crafted and the way that it flows and how the ideas themselves are presented and what kind of spacing is in there. And we just naturally have a jazzier feeling to it. I think it really would take somebody who understands the saxophone, maybe probably a saxophone musician themselves, someone who's played the instrument, to really get in and create a metal song that feature, or a rock song that features saxophone, that doesn't sound jazzy. And it's going to just be an understanding of how to perform the piece. Yeah, that was not supposed to be that long, but train of thought just kept going. Anyways, let's get back to Ishan. The next thing I wanted to talk about was the guitar solo. Why did I want to talk about the guitar solo, though? Oh, yeah, because this was an interesting guitar solo. So here's what the guitar is played. Bum, 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 bum. Probably the wrong notes, whatever. The idea is the same. Start on a note, go up to the next note, come down and hold it. And over and over and over and over. It's kind of a boring idea on paper, but the neat thing about guitars is that they're electric instruments. We can modify the way they sound, and we can introduce chaos into the end result. And that's what happened here. There were a couple of effects pedals that create varying metamorphosizing sonic qualities to the guitar tone. So even though he's holding out of note, you know, maybe the EQing on the high end and the low end are in flux, so it kind of feels like it's phasing in and out, and maybe there's a crackling element to it, and maybe there's automation on the volume to it. So it just has this really nice movement to it, even though we're just staying on a static note. And again, it's the idea of going simple when simple works, right? Found a way to allow chaos to control the flow of this melody. On paper, it's just three notes, but what you hear is a lot of movement, and Ishan's not in control of any of that. The effects pedals are. So it's just a really neat way of creating something simple and allowing effects to determine how it sounds. It's something I've had a problem. I'm not real good at giving up the reins, especially not to chaos, but it is something I've been playing around with more and more lately as I'm getting into digital instrumentation. And it's just really neat to hear stuff like that, because a lot of metal is, you know, composed the way it needs to be and, you know, very strictly written. It really is electronic music that tends to go into this realm. And it's really neat to hear the merger there, having an electric guitar not being played quickly or with expertise or anything like that. And him just saying, you know what, three notes will do, and we'll let the effects control the flow of the solo. So yeah, just really neat, and I love that angle there. The last thing I want to talk about real quick, going back to the saxophone, because I wasn't done with that. We got to hear the saxophone isolated at the end of the track, and here we got to hear the, vibrato on it. And this was really, really awesome. It actually made me question if this is a real saxophone or if it's just a really high quality saxophone library done digitally. Because this is a wide vibrato. It is gorgeous, but it's also very precise. We go exactly up to a certain volume and down to a certain volume. It's like it's a very wide, but it's very precise. If someone is performing this, their vibrato technique is gorgeous, 100% wonderful. And I really hope that somebody tells me, yeah, this is blah, blah, blah. He always does Ishan saxophone work. You should check out more of it. You can hear him in this song, like, I want a comment like that so bad, because I want to know that somebody's perfected the saxophone vibrato. Obviously, the style of vibrato doesn't work for everything, but at least in this case, just the control that is required for the width and specificity of, you know, the exact height and the high and the low of the vibrato, just, it's inhuman, but we've also heard a lot of inhuman things on this channel, so I'm not putting it past anybody at this point. But to my ears, the saxophone sounded really natural throughout the song until we heard it in isolation. And I was like, that's a bit too perfect. So I'm curious about that. You know, now that I'm thinking about it too, that would not work. Because it was across multiple notes too. I was going to say maybe they just recorded a snippet of it and then copy-pasted, you know, and created this one single take that never happened kind of idea. But no, because that same vibrato was across, like, several notes. Yeah. The more I think about it, the more I'm leaning towards it being a sample library. But I would just love to know that it's somebody really doing that. Just this beautiful embouchure control and air control to make this perfect sound. All right, let's get into the lyrics here. You know, this is what I love about metal songs. It's a 10-minute song and there's barely any lyrics at all. Makes these sections go by real quick. Let's see. So verse one, so we do have like a verse one and then they call it a refrain, but I mean, and then verse two and then the refrain and then verses 3-6 and then it's over. So yeah, very linear, and there is a single moment where we repeat lyrics. That might have been what I picked up on when I said it wasn't entirely linear. But so we have Quiet Surface, Blurred Reflection, Heaven's Mirror, Calm Awaiting. That's our first verse. Very simple, very straightforward, metaphorical, but everything talking about reflective surfaces. A quiet surface, I'm going to assume, is like a pond or a lake or a pool, just any, you know, body of water that isn't moving. Blurred reflection is not like a quiet surface, but, you know, in the realm of reflective surfaces, it's blurred though. Heaven's mirror, there we go again, and calm awaiting. The calmness goes along with the quiet surface. So something is presenting a reflection of a blurred image. It's also the idea of heaven's mirror. I'm not sure where we're going with that, but we'll see. And then the refrain just repeats like glass until it breaks. And yeah, I mean, like when you throw something in the river or something, or shatter a mirror or just whatever reflective surface, you can easily destroy the reflection. Peaceful silence, pressing void, moving shadows in the melody. So this is not really the exact opposite, but we see a similar vein here with the, because reflection is light, right? Mirrors, bodies of water, whatever, they reflect light. Here, we're talking about things that absorb light, or, you know, kind of metaphorically. Silence isn't really light, but it's sound, and they can kind of go together, right? Silence is a lacking of sound. Then we have the pressing void, which is a lacking of light, and shadows, which is a blocked light, right? It's when an object blocks a light source, and then we get, you know, the darkened outline. So, yeah, we have, like, opposites here. We have something that bounces light around, and we have something that absorbs light and creates darkness. Other than the pure concepts of light and dark, I really have no idea what's going on, though. The refrain comes back again, like glass until it breaks. Interesting. We're not talking about reflective surfaces anymore, but we still have something that is perfect until it breaks. All right. Verse 3, we also pick up more syllables per line, though we're still looking at 4-line stanzas. No ships set sail on this ocean, no longer gazing from the shores, no screams drowning in septic storm, but echoes of remorse. So what are they, like a port or a shore? Boats have in the past taken off here, but it says no ships are sailing here. No one is standing on the shore gazing upon those leaving. There's no one screaming in septic storm. No echo, but there are echoes of remorse. So people, there's not much going on here, but people are remorseful of what is going on. A formless drift was sculpture. Sorrow bound the sunken tower, world is broken, long lost kingdom, this wrecking Atlantis. Now beyond the prominent sun, the call of crystal waves, the crops of crimson fire as the ocean drinks the sun. Deep, deep down, the mouth of pandemonium opens wide, deep, deep down when it's not that beast. Yeah, I don't know. We have light versus dark, and then echoes of remorse on an ocean that doesn't have ships on it. A sunken tower, broken world, long lost kingdoms. Beyond the prominent sun, crops of crimson fire and oceans drinking the sun. Yeah, I don't know. I'm kind of getting like a damnation vibe with some of this. I don't necessarily know if it's alluding to hell, but definitely a place where spirits go. Like, I'm kind of getting like, what is it? The River Styx kind of vibe. The call of crystal waves and the crops of crimson fires. The ocean drinks the sun. And then, like, deep down, the mouth of Pandemonium opens wide. Lost Kingdom, Sunken Towers, everything is talking about, beneath stuff, right? We're so far beyond the prominent sun, which I kind of assume is our solar system sun. We're beyond that. And my first instinct was like in space, like we've gone to another solar system. But also, going along with all the other ideas here, maybe we've just moved so far underground, right? Obviously, typically hell or Hades or, the bad afterlife is not underground, but it's always below, right? We always have this concept of it being below our plane, where heaven is above, or whatever the good afterlife is, So like I'm kind of getting allusions to that, but I can't really say that there's any strong analogy that puts me there. It's just where my brain is going given all of these terms. But maybe that's not what's being spoken about here at all. Maybe that's just what my brain is pulling together based on these very desperate ideas I'm taking from all these various verses. But then also the light versus dark, and that kind of brings in a lot of things. And if I'm thinking about hell, also like God versus Satan or whatever. But then if I am thinking of like what did I oh the River Styx, that puts us at Zeus versus Hades, and while there is a rivalry there, it's certainly not the sort of cataclysmic war kind of vibe that God versus Satan kind of brings in their angels and demons holy war. So maybe the light versus dark doesn't work so well if it is talking more about Greek mythology. I don't know. I'm kind of lost here. This is where you guys come in. This is almost an hour-long video. I talked a lot about the music. I gave you that information. If you have any information on the poetry happening here, you toss that right back at me, okay? We'll learn from each other. That's what we do here. I tell you what I hear, you tell me what you know or what you hear. We open up conversations and both of us can deepen our understanding of music. Those are my thoughts on Ishan's undercurrent about water that takes you down. I'm getting more vibes for that idea of some sort of like negative afterlife concept. Anyways, this is where you guys come in. Hit me up in the comments. Let me know what you thought of this one. Anything that stood out to you? Anything that you'd like to add on to what I said or change what I said? Fix what I said. Whatever. If I was wrong about something, you want to give me more insight, go for it. Above the comments, if you could head into the description box, you'll find a link for Linktree. It takes you to this menu right here. It has links for everything related to the channel. You can pick up some merch, join the Patreon, join the Discord. Just a bunch of stuff. Go ahead and check it out. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. Greatly appreciate all three of those. Like, I don't have a thing for, like, ring the bell. I got that. I don't have, like, a hand symbol for subscribe. This is just, like, click. All right, that's not what I meant to do. We have a special selection coming up after this. Otherwise, I'll be back tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC, as usual. We're going to look at another saxophone, but not, what are we doing? But not jazz, and the final special selection for the week. Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.